Hi, let's talk about the larynx. The larynx is colloquially referred to as the voice box because within the larynx you have specialized folds called vocal cords that vibrate with exhalation as air is moved over them. The larynx as a space is going to connect the pharynx or your throat with your trachea. So it's going to sit anterior to the larynx atop the trachea. In terms of its neurovasculature, the larynx is supplied by superior and inferior laryngeal arteries. Superior laryngeal arteries are branches of the superior thyroid artery of the external carotid artery, whereas inferior laryngeal arteries are branches of the inferior thyroid artery coming off of the thyrocervical trunk of the first part of the subclavian artery. In terms of its innervation, the larynx is supplied by the vagus nerves. It's supplied by superior branches called the superior laryngeal nerves that come off of the vagus to supply the cricothyroid muscle as well as the mucosa superior to the vocal cords. And then there's the recurrent laryngeal nerves that descend down to the root of the neck. The right recurrent wraps around the subclavian artery, whereas the left recurrent laryngeal wraps around the concavity of the aorta, before ascending back up to the larynx to innervate all of the remainder of the intrinsic laryngeal muscles, as well as the mucosa inferior to the vocal cords. So the larynx is comprised of several laryngeal cartilages, and these are largely hyaline cartilage, but they do tend to calcify as people get older. So in about an individual's 30s is when they may begin to calcify. So the most significant of the laryngeal cartilages is the thyroid cartilage, as we can outline here. And the thyroid cartilage sits atop the cricoid cartilage, and it's somewhat obscured by the thyroid gland here, but the posterior, we can see the laminae of the cricoid sitting there. So those are two of the larger cartilages. There's also a rather large epiglottic cartilage that connects to the thyroid that acts as a little leaflet that can aid in when people are swallowing material so that they don't enter into the laryngeal inlet. Sitting atop the cricoid cartilage are the arytenoid cartilages, arytenoid because they're shaped like a funnel. And these are going to be significant because the vocal ligaments, which are the basis of the vocal cords, attach between the vocal processes of these arytenoid cartilages anteriorly to the thyroid cartilage. Sitting atop the arytenoid cartilages are the corniculate cartilages. There are also paired cuneiform cartilages that are embedded in mucosa that you can't see here, that help to maintain the laryngeal inlet. So here we can see the larynx sectioned. So the larynx is supported from the hyoid by the thyrohyoid membrane. And this is a sagittal section of the larynx. And so we have not just half a hyoid, but we also have half an epiglottis. We have half of the thyroid there and then half of the cricoid. But we get a better sense of the cricoid cartilage. Here we can see the arytenoid cartilage and the corniculate atop it. And probably most important, we can see the vocal ligament running between the vocal process of the arytenoid cartilage anteriorly to the thyroid cartilage. Now above that vocal ligament is also a ventricular ligament that is going to form the basis for the ventricular or the false vocal fold superior to the vocal ligament. Now, with respect to the actions of the larynx, there are a couple of functions that it supports. The first is swallowing. And with respect to swallowing, this is more a function that is supporting the action of the digestive system. But because the pharynx is a shared aerodigestive pathway, what we need to do is close off the larynx, and that's going to involve the elevation of the larynx as well as the rotation of the epiglottis downward. And so that's going to happen there at the thyroepiglottic joint so that we don't have food materials or liquids entering into the conductive pathway of the respiratory system. The other functions of the laryngeal cartilages are more in the wheel well of the larynx itself, and these are going to pertain to breathing and vocalization. There are going to be a couple of associations between cartilages that are going to be important. First, associations between the arytenoid and the thyroid cartilage. So what we're doing with this vocal ligament, are we decreasing this space so that we decrease tension, or are we increasing this space so that we increase tension? Tension on the vocal ligament is going to control pitch. So the more tension, the higher the pitch. The lesser the tension, the lower the pitch. We can also adjust what's going on between the arytenoid cartilages themselves or between the arytenoids and the cricoids. So the cricoarytenoid joint is interesting in that it involves pivoting of the arytenoids so that we can either abduct or adduct the vocal folds, or we can slide the arytenoids closer to one another so that we can adduct or bring those vocal folds nearer to one another. So there are two joints that are going to support the mission of the larynx in both breathing and vocalization. And these are the cricothyroid joint, or the joint between the cricoid cartilage and the thyroid cartilage. And this is a pivoting joint. So what happens, and it's not illustrated here, but it's about there. It's between the cricoid cartilage and the inferior horn of the hyoid cartilage. And what happens is this can pivot, and that moves the thyroid cartilage anteriorly and inferiorly. And so this is going to increase tension on the vocal ligament. Or if we rock it back, that can decrease tension on the vocal ligament if we return back to standard anatomical position. With respect to the cricoarytenoid joint, there are a couple of things which we're capable of doing. So the arytenoids can pivot, so they're pivoting outward that way. And as they pivot outwards, they abduct, that's abduction, the vocal folds. So this is the position that is going to be supportive of breathing. The other thing that we're able to accomplish with the arytenoids is that we could rotate them the opposite direction so as to adduct or adduct the vocal ligaments or bring them into near approximation with one another. And this is going to be important for vocalization. So the vocal folds need to be close to one another so that when they vibrate that you can produce speech. You can also slide the arytenoids towards one another. That also helps with adducting the arytenoids and the vocal folds. So let's take one by one these intrinsic laryngeal muscles and explore the actions that they perform, how that affects the cartilage, how that affects the vocal ligament, and what that does to sound. So let's start with cricothyroid. The cricothyroid muscle runs between the cricoid cartilage and the thyroid cartilage, and as tension is applied to that muscle, the thyroid cartilage rocks anteriorly and inferiorly, and that's going to put more tension on the vocal ligament. So that's going to increase pitch. The cricothyroid muscle is the only intrinsic laryngeal muscle that's not innervated by the recurrent laryngeal branch of the vagus. In fact, it's innervated by the external branch of the superior laryngeal nerve. Next up, we have a very important set of muscles called the posterior cricoarytenoid muscles. So these are between the cricoid cartilage and the arytenoid cartilages. These rotate the arytenoid cartilages. So they pull them that way, and that abducts the vocal ligaments. When the vocal ligaments are adducted, we're able to move air at its maximum capacity through the larynx. So this is a muscle of respiration or ventilation. And these are controlled by the recurrent laryngeal nerve. And sometimes I find that it is it's a little disconcerting that we only have one pair of muscles that are aiding in maintaining a patent airway. But here they are when viewed from the posterior. Across there, you've got one on either side supporting the patency of the airway. We have several sets of muscles that adduct the vocal folds. Two that are very closely related are the transverse and the oblique arytenoid muscles. The transverse and oblique arytenoid muscles can be seen here. The transverse muscles have transverse fibers, whereas the oblique have oblique fibers. And these are good at both gliding the arytenoid cartilages together so as to adduct the vocal ligaments for vocalization. There are also parts of the oblique arytenoid that are important for drawing down the vocal inlet so as to make that smaller. Both of these muscles are innervated by the recurrent laryngeal nerve. We also have lateral cricoarytenoid muscles. So crico, because they originate on the cricoid cartilage, arytenoid out to the muscular process of the arytenoid cartilages. These muscles are going to rotate the arytenoid cartilages, and when they do, that brings the vocal ligaments into closer approximation, or it will adduct the vocal folds for vocalization. And these muscles are also controlled by the recurrent laryngeal nerve. And then finally, we have muscles that span between the arytenoid cartilages and the thyroid cartilage. These are called thyroarytenoid muscles. Now, generally, the thyroarytenoid muscles are going to pull the arytenoid cartilages forward. And in so doing, they're going to decrease pitch. But there are also specialized fibers of the thyroarytenoid muscle located here and here, immediately adjacent to the vocal ligaments, that are capable of finely adjusting tension on the vocal ligament, and sometimes even pulling on the vocal ligament laterally so as to change the mass of the vocal ligament. This both allows the muscle to finely adjust pitch and change timbre as well. And these are known as vocalis muscles. Some sources consider vocalis muscles their own individual muscles, and some consider them specialized fibers of thyroarytenoid muscle. However, both of these muscles are in the same locations and are innervated by the same recurrent laryngeal nerves. When we look at the larynx, and here is a view of the larynx from the posterior, and it's been opened along the midline, so this has been cut and the edges have been abducted away, we're able to see the various spaces of the larynx. And so here's the epiglottic cartilage there. And when air enters into the larynx or comes out of the larynx, it goes through the laryngeal inlet and it enters the laryngeal vestibule. From the laryngeal vestibule, we could descend inferiorly into a space called the rima vestibuli. The rima vestibuli is the space between these false vocal cords. The false vocal cords don't vibrate during vocalization, but they can vibrate to produce a sound. So if you've ever heard of throat singing, that's the vibration of the false vocal cord. So let me give you an example of this. Those are my false vocal cords, not my true vocal cords. So that's something that you can perform at home so that you can feel what it's like to vibrate those. As we move inferiorly past the rima vestibuli, there's the laryngeal ventricle. So this is the space between the vestibular or ventricular or false vocal folds and the vocal folds or the true vocal folds. So the false vocal folds are above and the true are below, and between them is the ventricle. From the ventricle, we are then in the space called the rima glottidis. And so the rima glottidis plus the true vocal folds is called the glottis. And then the space below the glottis is called the infraglottic cavity. And the infraglottic cavity is going to extend down to the bottom of the cricoid cartilage, and it's going to be continuous with the trachea. So we've talked a little bit about the larynx and its role in breathing and sound production. We've talked about its cartilages, its muscles, and its spaces. Thank you.